In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome sky, and there was evening and there was morning the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on earth that bear fruit with the seed in it." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let there be signs, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky." So God created great sea monsters and every living creature that moves, and every kind with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening and there was morning the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." God said, "See, I have given you every plant-yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree whose seed and its fruit you shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and every bird of the air, and everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. The epistle reading this morning is from 2 Corinthians chapter 13, and that's on page 186.
Other assistant pastor was supposed to preach that Sunday, and he got sick. And the senior pastor, on a Saturday night, decided he didn't want to preach. Called me up and said, "You're preaching tomorrow." Wonderful. And as I was praying about my future, this was the text. Go. 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 The whole linchpin of this text is that word, go. What do you think about when you think about this word, go? As a kid of the 50s and 60s, I remember all the space missions, and we would wait anxiously from glued to the television set, and we'd wait to hear, "It's a go, it's a go, it's a go." And then we'd wait to see the rocket take off. What are some of the other images? Well, I like movies, especially military movies. And you ever see that movie Patton? Remember that movie Patton, where there's this boondoggle where the army is kind of at a crossroads and they can't figure out how to alternate, kind of like when you drive in New Jersey? You know? And Patton jumps down with all the stars and starts directing traffic and Omar Bradley. And a quiet voice says, "Well, George, I always knew you'd make a wonderful traffic cop." Bradley was asked about that, how Patton, with all his reactivity, was, and Bradley was pretty soft-spoken. And Bradley said, when asked how he dealt with Patton, he said, "Well, having that additional star means I didn't have to raise my voice." Think about that. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go there. Baptize. Go therefore, proclaim. Go therefore. Go, go, go. So I left Waterloo and I went to Moundsville, West Virginia. Moundsville, West Virginia. It was the first church that emerged when the old United Presbyterian Church in the USA had emerged. First church that very night, they had taken the two churches and made themselves one. My predecessor had been removed by the presbytery. He had been ultimately defrocked for a whole long list of things. I was 24 years old. Gosh, that seems forever ago. Wow. And I remember just digging in as a pastor, getting to know the people and enjoying all that ambiance of West Virginia. Now, I should also mention that in West Virginia, in Moundsville, the men's maximum security prison was there. In this old, ancient 1850 prison. Well, I had my first annual meeting of the congregation, and there was this crusty old West Virginia elder. I still remember him so well. His name was Steve Kearns, and he stood up in the middle of the meeting, and I thought, well, this could be interesting. And he said, "I have something to say to the congregation. I want to criticize you because you believe in four-wall Christianity, and the gospel says we should go into the world." Well, that was Steve's main concern. He was really active in Gideon's. He was really active in the community, and he was always, always in front of the congregation saying we must not have four-wall Christianity. We've got to go. We've got to go. When I was 24 and I was full of spunk. So I decided to have some fun with Steve. So I called him up and I said, "Hear what you're saying about four-wall Christianity." "That's right, Pastor, or Reverend. We need to get out in the community." "That's right, Reverend. We need to witness in the community." "That's right, Reverend. I worked downtown with people. I was a lion then." "Steve, I want you to come over to the church and we're going to go out to the community." "Wonderful, Reverend." Well, he came over to the church and I said, "Come on, Steve, we're going to take a walk." And the men's maximum security prison is 2 blocks from the church. So Steve and I walked down to the church, from the church to the men's maximum security prison, and we knocked on the door. The door opened. We were invited in and sat down with an assistant warden, and together I said, Christmas Eve, our board of deacons taking Christmas presents to the prison after our service and going into the darkest place of that prison, appropriately called a hole, and giving these guys in solitary confinement some expression of Christian love. We abandoned formal Christianity. Wow. Maybe there's something to this. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. In this church, you are doing that with the homeless, with the hungry. You're doing it with children in our preschool. And as I struggled with this text this week, I won't go into too long because we're kind of confined for time, but ask me about it when we have our picnic. The Holy Spirit still speaks through divine coincidence, and the Holy Spirit offers opportunities for us to go into the world. We have a story to tell, and we have love to share. We have a Lord to worship, not just in word, but in deed. So the scripture begs us to ask today,